Recently, I had the pleasure of interviewing 6 young adult horror authors who all shared what they believe to be the best tips for writing truly scary horror. And today, I'm going to share with you my favorite 10 tips from all of those interviews in a nice, neat, condensed format. Because I'm nice like that. So watch this video if you want to learn how to write horror or if you are an aspiring horror author, because it's going to be jam-packed with many, many cool tips about horror writing and the horror writing craft. If you are new to this channel, hello, welcome. My name is Claire Fraze, and I am the author of young adult supernatural thriller They Stay, which contains many horror elements but isn't actually a horror book because I am scared of things. Each of the tips that I share with you in this video came from one of the 6 young adult horror authors that I interviewed. All of the full interviews, if you'd like to watch them, are linked in the description of this video and also in my video history on my channel. I had the pleasure of chatting with young adult horror authors Dawn Kurtigich, Kat Winters, Kat Ellis, Emma Berquist, and more. So if you're interested in checking out all of their tips, because they shared many more than the ones that I will be sharing with you in this video, definitely go check out their interviews. So without further ado, let's get into the tips. 1. Use all 5 senses when describing things. As you probably know, because you are a human being, fear manifests itself in the body in a very physical way. Your breathing gets shorter, your heart starts pounding, your skin feels clammy, everything around you feels heightened. If you want to experience this because you can't think of any examples or know what this feels like just off the top of your head, go do something that scares you and pay attention to your body. For example, if you're afraid of the dark, go stand in a dark room and close your eyes and pay attention to the way that your body feels doing that thing. Your senses are gonna feel heightened. You're gonna be more hyper aware of all the things that are going on around you that you can hear, that you can touch, that you can smell, because you have that fight or flight just burning in your head. When you are writing horror and thriller books, you want to convey this fear through your writing. You want to make your readers feel the fear that your characters are feeling, because that's the whole point of picking up a horror or a thriller book, because your reader wants to have that same scared sensation. One of the things you can do to achieve this is by writing with all of your 5 senses: sight, smell, sound, touch, and taste. I personally have a bad habit of only describing things with sight in my early drafts. I have to go back and do whole revision passes where I try to make my world a little bit more 3-dimensional. Even though you can't rely on things like scary music or jump scares in your horror writing like you can when you are watching horror on TV or writing screenplays, you are able to use this to your advantage and bring all of these 5 senses into your writing to create an even more intense emotional experience for the reader. But while it's important to describe things using all of these 5 senses, you also don't want to spend paragraphs upon paragraphs when your characters are just standing there describing the way that even little things feel, because that will drag down your pacing. So that brings me to my 2nd tip, which is that you need to keep your characters moving through the scene. Do not have your characters stop, look around, and describe things, especially in a really intense part of a horror or thriller novel. You want your characters to describe things as they physically move through a scene. For example, if your character enters a haunted house, have them go into the house looking for something or running from something. Don't have them just walk into the house and stand there and look around and describe what they're seeing. If they are actively looking for something, they can describe things along the way. They can describe how maybe the floorboards are creaking under their weight as they're moving through the house, or the layer of dust that billows up into a cloud around them as they move an old book or something like that. In every scene, your character needs to want something. And in horror, a lot of times this is, you know, getting away from something or getting towards something. So if you have that intense want and show your character working towards that in the scene, sprinkle your description in around it. It's gonna help add a little bit of color to the environment that your character is in without it dragging down the pacing and have your readers wondering why you're spending 3 pages describing something that was exciting when now, because you've been describing it for 3 pages, it's not quite as exciting. All that being said though, my 3rd tip is don't be overly descriptive. You want to pull readers into your story and make them feel the visceral emotions that your characters are feeling. However, you don't want to be overly descriptive because you want to leave enough space for your reader's imagination to fill in the blanks. One of the things that makes horror really scary is the unknown. People are scared of things that they don't understand, so a threat that somebody doesn't understand is going to be scarier than a very clearly delineated threat that you understand what it is, why it's doing what it's doing, and how you kill it. In the movie Jaws, for example, you don't see the shark until about halfway through the movie. In my opinion, this makes the first half even scarier because the viewers are left to imagine what that shark looks like. Their imagination fills in that blank with this scary, terrible, bloodthirsty shark that is always going to be scarier than the actual shark that they put in that movie. Because the reader's imagination is going to scare them way more than you ever could as a writer, it's very important to leave certain descriptions vague in order to harness that power of your reader's own imagination to scare them and have that work in your favor. So keep your descriptions vague when you're describing things like monsters, or if your character sees something really scary, add in a couple of little small details, but don't be overly descriptive because then your reader's imagination can just take that and run with it, which is gonna make your horror all the more scary. The fourth tip is build your horror around universal human fears. Some universal human fears include the unknown, include the powerless feeling of something else taking over our body, what happens after we die, what's in the ocean, what's in space, what's in the dark that we can't see. Have you ever wondered why so many kids are afraid of the dark when most kids haven't been taught to be afraid of the dark? Being afraid of the dark is instinctual, and like some lizard part of our brains is afraid of the dark because we can't see our enemies coming and our senses are not as heightened at night as other animals around us who could harm us. If you can center your horror story around something innately scary like that, most people will be able to connect to it. It's gonna resonate with people because they're afraid of that thing too. My fifth tip is write what scares you. You specifically, not what you think is gonna scare other people. Pay attention to what scares you. When you watch horror or read horror, which you really should be doing if you wanna become a horror author because that's the best way that you're gonna learn how to do this, write down the things that actually work for you. Write down the things that make you scared, that keep you thinking about it afterwards. Keep some sort of running list of all these things so that when it comes time for you to write your own story, you can look at this list and understand how you reacted to a lot of common things that people put in horror stories, and you can emulate that and put something similar into your story. And think critically about what the things on your list have in common. Are they all having to do with the dark? Are they all having to do with some sort of loss of control or a feeling of powerlessness? Or do they all have to do with something like a fear of brutality or some really, really nasty, gory thing potentially that could happen to a character? If it scares you, chances are it'll also scare your readers. Six, don't give your readers all the answers. This connects back to not being overly descriptive, but this has to do with your plot. If you understand what something is, why it is there, why it's doing what it's doing, and what you can do to stop it, it stops being as scary as if you have no idea what the answers to any of those questions are. Think about it. What would scare you more? An imaginary threat that you could hear knocking over your things whenever you slept at night and you could feel pulling on your toes while you lay in bed with like the covers up to your nose? Or a ghost who you could see and communicate with that you knew could be killed by, I don't know, a super soaker filled with holy water. In my opinion, ghost stories where you can't see the ghosts, but they can physically affect you and potentially harm you are way scarier than ghost stories where you can see the ghosts or where they can't touch you. My seventh tip is to use creepy language and repeat creepy details. Use emotionally charged descriptions that are always relating back to the physical sensations of fear within your characters. An exercise that helped me that I did after actually one of these interviews was I chose a couple of mundane objects and I tried to describe them using language that was creepier than language that I would normally use to describe that thing. This comes down to word choice and also what you compare certain mundane objects to that can be a lot more ominous. And find small ways in your scenes to turn up the creepiness factor that may not necessarily impact the plot, but can really make the audience feel something like that something's not right. Things as small as having the lights maybe be dimmed when characters walk into a room and having the light cast creepy shadows onto the wall, reflecting off of all the normal objects in the room. Describing what those shadows look like would be a much creepier description of the room than if everything was bright and there were no shadows. You can also repeat creepy details. You can choose certain things that scare you, maybe like in some books I've read, there have been repeated descriptions of eyes staring at you and being, you know, gouged out of people's skulls, or of moths like landing on you or following you, and bugs and things like that. If you can choose one or two of those things, really mostly one per book because otherwise it gets a little too overwhelming, and describe it repeatedly, that can also help you create a really creepy atmosphere that can be very effective when you're trying to unsettle your readers. But when it comes down to it, a lot of atmosphere is in the language itself. My eighth tip is to treat setting like a character. Don't just have your horror story happen in some sort of random, boring, normal town where things are familiar and feel very normal and nothing is weird or off-putting. Have there be weird off-putting things in the town that create an unsettling feeling within the reader. Employ the uncanny valley and make things kind of almost right and normal, but not quite right and normal. Like something is off about the whole place, but your reader can't put their finger on why. And once you've done that, take it a step further and create scary specific locations for you to set your scene. If you put a scene in a sealed environment, that is immediately going to make it more claustrophobic and raise the stakes. If you set a scene in a dangerous setting where a lot of things can go wrong, that is also going to raise the stakes of that scene. I challenge you to go back through your horror story and ask yourself if some of the scenes that you've written could potentially take place in other places that could heighten the stakes or make them more intense in some way. Could you take a scene that had previously happened just in someone's house and put it in a haunted house or put it on a bridge with a really scary river running underneath it? You can also use your setting to mirror the emotional situation of the plot or your characters, and you can also use it to have terrible things happen to your characters that make things even worse for them and therefore make the book way more entertaining to read. My ninth tip is make sure that you get to an authentic emotional core. To write a really scary horror book, you need to feature characters that your readers will connect with. You need a main character with concrete motivation, who your readers can root for, who is specific and not just a cardboard cutout. Your main character needs to have to want something and they need to have something standing in their way. If you are able to write a relatable and likable character who is also very specific and who the readers can picture and care about, that is going to be way more effective than writing a more cardboard cutout version of a character, because your readers are gonna care what happens to them and be way more invested in the scary stuff that happens in your story. When you're watching a movie and, you know, like that rando gets killed in the first 5 minutes of the movie, it's not really that traumatic to watch because you're not connected to that random character. But if that same tragic fate happened to the main character after you've been spending time with them and after you've come to care about them, it would be way more traumatic to watch or read about that. I've heard people give advice before where they say to write a character that is a little bit more general, that isn't super specific, that is very generally likable, but doesn't have a lot of defining personality traits so that your reader can project themselves onto the character when you're writing horror. I think this is terrible advice, and I really don't think that cardboard cutout characters are relatable at all. Even if your very specific character is different from your readers, you don't need your reader to see themselves in that character so much as you need your reader to care about that character. And if you give them some generally relatable traits, then, you know, I think that your readers are going to be connected to that character and relate to them more than just a generic cardboard cutout of a person. Because they're going to be reading your story and they're not going to just react to it like, ew, I hope that that horrible thing doesn't happen to this totally random stranger. They're going to be like, oh my god, I really hope that this terrible, horrible thing doesn't happen to this character who I absolutely adore. So make sure you spend a lot of time developing your horror characters, because that is honestly the most important part of writing a scary story. All the other stuff comes after, just like in every story, in my humble opinion. And 10, my final horror writing tip is remember the four pinnacles of horror. The four things that make every horror story truly scary. The unknown, a feeling of powerlessness, the uncanny valley, and the threat of brutality. I've made an entire video about this that I've linked in the description of this video, kind of breaking down this theory of mine that I have. But to basically sum it up, I believe that these four things are what differentiate scary writing from truly scary writing. And this is kind of my theory for what makes horror scary. And as I've been reading and watching a lot of horror, I've noticed these things in every single movie that really scared me. The idea behind the unknown is the less people know about a certain situation, the more scared they will be of it. The idea behind powerlessness is the less power that your character has in a certain situation, and the more power whatever antagonistic force has, the scarier that will be. The idea behind the uncanny valley is that if something is not quite right about a situation, a place, a monster, etc., the more unsettling it will be. Not necessarily scary, but that's an important layer to add to start creating this unsettling feeling in your reader leading up to the climax of your story. And finally, if your antagonistic force is able to inflict a horrible, painful, brutal death to your characters, the scarier they will be. If someone was chasing after me trying to hack me to pieces slowly with a chainsaw, you bet I would be running really, really fast. So if you can combine and include all four of these elements into one story, you are gonna have a very scary story. Again, in my video, I break down each of these four things and I show you real examples from different movies. So if you are interested, check it out. So that's it for my 10 horror writing tips. For more, make sure that you check out not only my How to Write Horror video, which I was just talking about and I linked in the description of this video, but also the amazing interviews that I did with these 6 young adult horror authors. I had wonderful conversations with each of them, and each of those interviews really served as its own little mini masterclass. So if you are interested in learning how to write horror, I highly recommend checking them out. I have ones on writing historical horror, ones on writing ghost stories, ones on more general horror writing tips. So yeah, links are in the description. Seriously, they're all amazing. I learned so much from them. If you enjoy this video, please make sure to hit that like button and subscribe to my channel. I make videos once a week sharing the actionable writing tips that helped me improve as a writer. Have a good week, everyone. And as always, happy writing.